Hello, everybody out there. My name is Jason Norton. I'm the pastor here at Kings Trail Cowboy Church, and I'm actually excited to do this little intro to the sermon because it's always a good thing to get your mind right and to get settled before you hear God's Word. And speaking of God's Word, I have a scripture for you. It's in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. It says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." So when Jesus said, "Will you come to me and find rest?" He also said for you and I to learn from him. So in this sermon section, I pray that you learn the words of Jesus. I pray that you learn the word of God. And as you're listening, just remember that this is God's word, and his promise to you is, faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So enjoy the message. I pray it blesses you, and not just you, but everything in your life. And we'll see you at the end. Love you. Bye-bye. Good morning. Could I see have the elders up here in Duane? Lord told me to do something today. He's told me several times about Dallas, but today we're going to make it public. Everybody say, "Good morning, Dallas." Say good morning.
Good morning.
There you go. We have Bentley. Fred's probably upstairs. Is Fred still upstairs? Can you get Fred down here, please? Is Bentley here today? Okay. This will be good. We know that God wants to stretch us and to grow us. Amen. Have us do things we're not used to. Who's not up there? Papa G, come on up, please. Daddy, you come here, please. Okay, Dallas, stand right here and face this way. There you go. Y'all get behind Dallas, please. Dallas, you want to stand up right there. Stand on there. I'll hold you. Stand on top of the Bible. There you go. Good. Good, 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 good. No reason to be scared. Amen. God wants to do a beautiful thing in your life today. How many of you believe the Bible?
Amen.
Amen. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, it says, "Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet." To the nations. Dallas, raise your hands up. In the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, I declare today as your earthly father that you're ordained a prophet for the nations. God has given you a ministry of fire. There will not be any cultural line or racial line that God will not allow you freely to flow to and fro. You will bless many people. You will be the beginning of a generation that refuses to run off. No need to see what the devil does to know how good God is. God's goodness will be good enough for you. In the name of Jesus Christ, in the name of Jesus Christ, by the laying of hands, not just the elders of the church, but the elders of your family, it is declared today in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Cheers. Go sit down. Wow, that's new to me. I was told when he was at lunch one day at school, he was on his knees praying before his food. And they asked him, he said, "Dallas, are you praying for your food?" And he said, "No, no, ma'am, I'm praying for everybody's food." Thank you, Jesus. Maylee, God has a word for you too, just not today. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you are spontaneous. I thank you, Jesus, there's at times you make us nervous, but it's because you want to move and you want to do something new. Lord, I thank you that the gospel never changes and never will. I thank you, Lord, that your word says if anybody comes preaching another gospel, even an angel, let that one be accursed. So, Lord, we thank you that your word reigns true in this place. We thank you that your word is true. I thank you, Lord, for stirring the hearts of fathers, because what that just did was stir the hearts of moms and dads to see what child is actually sleeping in their house. What is God's plan for them in their life? It's not just the plans of mom and dad, but God ordains things long before anybody even knows what seminary is. I thank you, Jesus, that you call us, and when you call us, may we come running. Lord, may you bless your word today. May it be sanctified by the blood of the Lamb, and may your name always be honored in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, his word, this may have happened to you while you've been reading the Bible. There's times I read the Bible, and maybe this would resonate with some of you, that as you read it, you might think, when did they put that in there? You know, and it's what's strange is at times if you read the Bible a whole bunch, I believe that's why it says in Hebrews chapter 4 that the Bible, the Word of God, is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. That a living thing, all of us in here may have known somebody, and after you begin to know them, you realize sometimes you didn't know everything about them, that you learned something new about them. Amen. Today you learned something new about Dallas. Ever since he was born, I know that God has placed his fire on him, his fire. And I ask that every parent or guardian in here who watches over a child, ask the Lord to show you something about your children. And he will. He'll show you something about your child. He'll give you a specific word. This is all biblical. You'll see it even in the Old Testament, where before a father dies or passes away, he will then bless each one of his children with a specific word. It's not like a blanketed statement for every one of them. It's a specific word for a specific child for a specific season in their life. And as I was reading the Bible this past time, I came across a verse and I went, I never realized that. I was almost, you know, dumbfounded and scratching my head going, how many times have I read that and I never took notice of that? How many know that God can hide something from you sometimes? And then he can reveal it. Even we know that on the road to Emmaus, it says, and then he opened our eyes to the scriptures after the breaking of the bread. So Jesus can still, he says, the Bible says he never changes and he never will. And Jesus will open your eyes to the scriptures. And then as I was reading, I came across, it's in Exodus chapter 7. I'm not going to camp out there, but just kind of catch you up. You know that we serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Christ our Lord. And we all know the promises of Abraham, what was given to him. And then Isaac, when Abraham and Sarah had Isaac, Then Isaac had Jacob and Esau, and Jacob was later called Israel because he toiled and wrestled with God all night long. And it was very interesting if you don't just read and study one story, but read and study a continuing story, and you'll see that even in the Bible, that God, even in the Old Testament, you'll see that God will not be mocked. Every man will reap what he sows. How many know that's just as powerful in the Old Testament as it is in the New Testament? And what Jacob did is he deceived his daddy. He tried to make himself out to be Esau, even put goat skin and hair on his hands because Esau was a hairy man, a hunter. And Jacob was, they said, as a smooth-skinned man, and he was tend to hang out at the house more often. So Jacob deceived his daddy, and naturally, God will not be mocked. Every man reaps what he sows. He runs into a deceiving daddy. Amen. Is that me? And so as we learn on the way back, Jacob ends up having 12 sons, and that's where we get the 12 tribes of Israel. The 12 tribes of Israel, we're going to another story with Joseph and the coat of many colors, and all his brothers are jealous of him, and they end up throwing him or selling him into slavery, and went back and told his daddy that he handed him the coat full of blood and said maybe something had a wild beast had killed him. But Joseph ends up being number two in charge of Egypt. He's number one under Pharaoh in Egypt. And long story short, many of you know the story, but in the end, he saves in a great drought, in a great drought of the land, of not just food, but also in water, that Joseph ends up bringing his entire family to Egypt. Pharaoh goes, bring your family here, and they can live off our land. And so he brings, how many of y'all know how many went with his family? Anybody? I know it's not fair, you didn't get to study before Sunday, but 70 people from his family then went to Egypt. And the Bible declared and prophesied that said, you will go and serve, everybody say serve. You will go and serve a stranger in a strange land. And they'll be harsh to you. At the very first chapter of the book of Exodus, it says that the taskmasters were very harsh to the Israelites. And as they go to serve, this 70 people turns into 1.5 to 2 million people. Accurately, that's an estimation, but the Bible says it's 600,000 men. And when the Bible says 600,000 men, that meant 600,000 men who are capable and able to go to war at any given time. So that 70 turned into 600,000 men of war. And then, you know, the story of Moses, the first 40 years of his life, he's called and he's raised up in Pharaoh's house. And then the next 40 years after he killed somebody, they found out about it. So he took off running. He was scared. The next 40 years of his life, he spends in the wilderness. And he has that burning bush experience. He said, take off your sandals, for you're standing on holy ground. And eventually God, Yahweh, comes back and says, go back and set my people free. You go back and you be my representative to set my people free. And he argues with him back and forth, and there's a whole teaching in that, how we sometimes argue with God, but in the end, guess what? God has his way. God will always have his way. And then he goes back, and then God has some specific instructions on what he's going to say to Pharaoh, and at the very beginning, you're going to remember it when I say it. But then the second part of this verse, it's like I've read it for many years, and I never picked up on this part. Exodus chapter 7, verse 16, it says, and you shall say to him, you, Moses, shall say to him, Pharaoh, the Lord God of the Hebrews has sent me to you, saying, let my people go. Everybody knows that part, right? Comma, so they might serve me in the wilderness. Did you realize one of the reasons why God wanted to set his people free is so that they would leave slavery and bondage and go and serve God? And what I learned right off the bat in these set of scriptures, all the way from Exodus chapter 1 to Exodus chapter 7, I learned that we're all going to serve somebody. Are we listening? To include yourself, you can serve yourself. You know, another interchangeable word that the Bible uses is not just serve, but it's also worship. Go and set my people free
so that they may come and worship me. Did you know that when you worship God this morning, as the band led us in praise and worship, that is a form of serving God. When you stood up or when you started worshiping God in your heart, because you can worship God sitting down and your heart just start glowing with gratitude and thanksgiving, and you sit there and you start to worship God in your heart, that is serving God. Do you realize that? Did you realize that as you worship God, that is a form of serving God? Did you realize as you serve God, that is a form of worshiping God? Interchangeably. But it never occurred to me that he said, let my people go that they may serve me in the wilderness. You know what that wilderness was called? This is crazy. You can't make this up. The wilderness of sin. Are we not living in a wilderness of sin right now? And that he's called us. Moses is a type and shadow of Jesus. Matter of fact, Moses himself said, God, everybody say God. God will raise up a prophet like me. Amen. He said, I'll raise up a prophet like me. And he is a type and shadow of our Jesus Christ. I don't know what's going on. Maybe it's the wires. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, help even the speaker. Might go Pentecostal and have to just get rid of all amplifiers and speakers and just start shouting. Amen. I had to do that one Sunday. It made me really nervous. I don't know why. It's a difference, Brother Daniel, between preaching the word and shouting it the whole time. Amen. Psalm chapter 2, verse 11 says, serve. Everybody say serve.
Serve,
serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. It is a beautiful feeling. If any of you want to have a brave prayer, you ask this to the Lord in your heart. You say, Lord, I do desire to serve you, but show me what it means to rejoice with trembling. I've been at a couple altars where I fell out, and it wasn't no religious type of crazy TV evangelist type deal. I don't know none of that. But what I do know is the power of God is still alive today in 2018. And it can, if you desire to see, he can put you right on the floor and you're sitting there totally rejoicing, but at the same time, you're trembling. You're trembling. I remember laying at an altar at a church in Leonard one night, and I was sitting there and my hands were shaking and I was weeping, laying down at the altar, and about 15, 20 minutes into it, I was still saying, Lord, I don't want to get up. I just want to be in your presence. I just want to continue. And I said, Lord, forgive me. May I repent for thinking that heaven's going to be boring. Amen. How many of you ever heard the liar lie about heaven to you, saying we're all going to be hanging out on a cloud with some wings? That's craziness. I can see me 1,000 years in glory still crying. You're like, where's Jason? We're going to go over here and see this thing over here. And he's like, he's still crying. He won't get up. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Psalm 72:11 says, yes, all kings shall fall down before him. All nations shall serve him. Psalm 100 verse 2 says, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Even the Bible declares in Psalm 100, it says how we serve him as we come to him before him with gladness and singing. And y'all turn to Matthew chapter 4. I'm going to read something out of there. It's something that our Lord and King, Master Jesus, said in response to what the devil said. How many of you know that the book in the Bible, there's nothing written out of coincidence? Everything has a great amount of detail to it. God, the Holy Spirit, who inspired man to write the book, is perfect, holy, and true, and the words in it are just as perfect, holy, and true. If you believe that, say amen. Matthew chapter 4, starting at verse, let's say 8. This is the third temptation the devil came at Jesus with. Matthew 4:8 says, again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. Why did he take him to a mountain? You think it's coincidental that God, Yahweh, told Moses, tell Pharaoh to let my people go so they may come what? Serve me or come worship me where? On a mountain, Mount Sinai. It's not coincidence that the devil has nothing new. He tries to mock and copy God. He tries, but it doesn't work. Amen. He said he took him up on a high mountain. He's trying to be God. Just as it says in Isaiah, there's 3 or 6 I statements saying, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do this. And he was kicked out of heaven for that. And again, he's still trying to, this is funny, he's trying to act like he's God while he's talking to God. Hello. Amen. Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. I can't imagine what Jesus was saying in that moment. He's like, yeah. You can just see him thinking in his heart, yeah, I made this mountain. And I made you. And the arrogance to think that you can control me. But he's showing us a type and a shadow, a pattern to follow. He said, it is written. Verse 9, and he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me, or if you would serve me. Then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan! Exclamation point. Sometimes you do get loud with him. For it is written, you shall worship. Everybody say worship. Worship. You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. It's not coincidence. Even Jesus' response to the devil was saying, worship and serving. Same thing. When you serve God, you're worshiping God. When you're worshiping God, you're serving God. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. Turn to Luke chapter 12. And thank you, Jesus. As I'm reading God's word, in between services, the Lord was talking to me about the word serving and worshiping, serving, more so on the serving part. I believe there's people out there that will try to manipulate a message just to get to people to help out more at church. How many of you know that ain't me? I'm not trying to get people. We didn't have a leadership meeting last week, and we were like, ain't nobody helping. Well, you need to preach on serving. How many of you know this church doesn't operate like that? We'll shut these doors and nail it up before we start trying to manipulate people into doing what we think needs to happen. We'll just call that a season without. Amen? So if you're thinking that, that's a lie from the devil, and that ain't from us. Amen? The other thing he was showing me was this, is that many times if you hear a word or a message about serving, many people can immediately feel condemned. Amen? Because they feel like they're not doing enough, but this is the perspective. Sometimes we just need to switch our perspective on how we're viewing things. And I felt like God was saying this. Tell them that this service will bless people because somebody out there is waiting for you to serve God. Was it not somebody who was serving God that came and blessed you? Was it not somebody that was serving God that came and prayed for you? Was it not somebody who was serving God that came and brought you a message? Was it not somebody who was serving God that called you on the phone? Amen. I know that people in my life, when they were actively serving God, is when I was blessed. I remember the last job or career I had when I was calling out to the Lord. How many of you know you can call out to the Lord and it not be with your mouth just yet? You just know your heart's stirring. You need some help, but you're too prideful to open up your mouth and say you need it. Amen. How many know that God can see your heart stirring before you even mention it? The Bible says in the Old Testament, I will perfect. Everybody say perfect. I will perfect that which concerns you. So you belong to God. Something's concerning you. He's already sending an answer your way. But I believe that as you listen to this message, don't you dare feel condemned. But know this, God has people out there waiting for you to serve him, because by your serving, you're going to bless them and some bring some to Christ. Amen? Some are going to come to Christ. Luke chapter 12, verse 35, the faithful servant and the evil servant. I started seeing, you know, just said that word, let my people go so they may serve me. I started seeing all the different words of servant. You know, one of the titles or identification marks is you as a Christian, you're called a servant of God. The Passion Translation would call you a lover of God. Amen? The servant of God. And here he's about to give a parable about a faithful servant and an evil servant. I don't know about y'all, but right there at the subtitle, I'll say, Lord Jesus, help me be a faithful servant. Faithfulness is one of those rare things these days. It's like an endangered species along with obedience. Amen. Lord Jesus, help us be a faithful servant and not an evil servant. Verse 35, all red letters, says, let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. What do you gird your waist with in Ephesians 6 in the armor of God? Now put on the full armor of God to fight in that evil day. When you've done all, stand. Amen. The helmet of salvation. You need to know your salvation. You need to know how you're saved and why you're saved. You need to know how to explain it. Not to be saved, but so you don't get a headshot from the enemy. How many know if you get hit in the head, that's some bad business. That's when they call the helicopter. Hello. You can dang near chop your arm off or your foot off, and you're good with just going in the ambulance. But somebody hits you in the head, and they're calling the helicopter. We need to see this as a soldier. We need to see this in real-life Christianity, in our circle of influence, in our families, in our jobs. If I get hit in the head, that's bad stuff. If I get hit in the arm, I might be able to continue. The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, for you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. I'm not saved by my righteousness. Nobody's saved by your righteousness. You're saved by the blood of Jesus, His righteousness. And when we understand that, that's when we walk. I don't walk condemned anymore because I know I'm walking according to His authority, not mine. I have none. And the belt of truth. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth. Everybody say truth. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. Gird up your mind with truth. That means think correctly. For God did not give me a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. We love the powerful part and we love the love part. But how many know that God wants you to think correctly about the things of God? Amen. So right off the bat, the first verse in verse 35, let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. I mean, you know, your lamps can run out of oil. Two lamps right there. Two lamps at the gate. Two lamps at the chapel. They both represent the two churches of Revelation Jesus had no issue with. Philadelphia and Smyrna. He had no issue with. The other five churches, he said, this I have against you. Amen. Do you know that it's possible to walk in such a way that Jesus himself, your master, your king, the creator of all things, you can walk in such a way that he has no issue with you? Wow, I don't know about y'all, but I want that. I want that. He said, desire more gifts. Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning and you yourselves. How many know that the kingdom of God is an individual relationship? You cannot live off somebody else's relationship with Jesus. I don't know about y'all, in the book of Acts, that caused seven sons of Sceva, got their butt whooped, ripped naked, and thrown out of their own house. Said, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? You know why? You know why? Why that demon-possessed person whooped him? Is because the seven sons of Sceva stood up and said, we cast you out by the Jesus that Paul preaches. You can't live your Christianity off of Christianity of somebody else. I can't live my walk with Jesus off of what Daniel's doing or not doing, or what Dwayne's doing or not doing. I got to live my walk with me and Christ Jesus. What am I doing? What is he telling me to do? What has he called me to do? Amen. Self-responsibility in the kingdom of God. He says, and you yourselves. It's a beautiful reminder of the kingdom of God. Jesus says, what about you? I love the famous preacher. He said this, what are you going to do about this man called Jesus? What are you going to do? And you yourselves be like men who wait for their master. Oh, if we had more men who waited on their master, hand and foot. It is a beautiful thing to serve. It's one of the most powerful things is to serve. The one who serves and continues to serve will experience unique blessings nobody else is going to get to partake in. What did he say? Well done, good and faithful. For you've been faithful with the little, I now put you in charge of what? Five cities. Well done, good and faithful. You've been faithful with the little, I now put you in charge of what? 10 cities. Are you a faithful servant? And you yourselves be like men who wait for their master when he will return from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, they may open to him immediately. Are you watching for the Lord? Blessed are those, what? Servants whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. Assuredly, I say to you that he will gird himself and have them sit down to eat. He will come and serve them. Wow, the master of all creation says, sit down. He'll gird himself. He said, I'm going to serve you. And if he should come in the second watch or come in the third watch and find them so, blessed are those servants. Verse 39. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. That scripture pops up in my spirit or my mind and thoughts from time to time. Raise your hand if you've ever been in an argument. There's some hands that didn't raise. I want to hang out with you after church. How's that possible? This is what the Lord reminds me of at times. If me and the bride have a disagreement, this happens occasionally. Not the disagreement part. That does happen occasionally. But what I'm about, my point, is that there's been times that I'm ready. She stated her case, and I'm about to make a really good point. Because you know if you make a good point, that ends the argument, right? You think it's going to, right? It's a lie, right? And every once in a while, the Holy Spirit will do this. What if I came back right now? How important is it now? Does that not persuade? Jesus is trying to change our perspective. He said, are you watching? Are you watching? Amen. And if I'm watching for him, then this really important thing doesn't seem so important anymore. I had a brother in Christ. I mean, you know, we can learn from each other all day long. What God has told you, he hadn't told me. What God has told me, he might not have told you, but us together make a strong body. Amen. My friend used to say DIME. D-I-M-E, acronym. Does it matter eternally? How many arguments will that shut down? How many I ain't getting my ways will that shut down? Amen. Verse 38, and if he should come in the second watch or come in a third watch and find them so, blessed are those servants. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Can you imagine that? Imagine if somebody just supernaturally told you at 4:22 p.m. on Tuesday afternoon, somebody's going to come to your house and steal all your chickens. How many of y'all will be sitting in the chicken coop? Yeah. Giggling. Saying, you about to get it. Right? I'm thankful that our Lord always calls his children to be ready. Because when this world's freaking out, spinning out of control, you can be sitting there peaceful and in comfort. Guess what? Giggling. You know, the Bible says the Lord laughs at his enemies. Verse 40, therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Every once in a while, I think we should do a little churchy test to see if we're being churchy. I mean, you know, you can accidentally start doing that and not even realize it. I mean, you can hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can hear the word. Like in the book of Acts, Cornelius' house, as the word was being preached, the Holy Spirit fell. Amen. But American church would teach you, you hold on real quick. Don't confess the Lord just yet. That's at the altar call. How many know that you can be talking to Jesus right now as I'm preaching? You don't have to wait to no altar call. You can just sit there and say, I'm done right now. I want to accept Christ as my Lord and Savior. And you just start calling out to him. It didn't say, anyone who calls out to me shall be saved as long as it's appropriately at the right time at the altar call at the end of church. It never says that. Amen. And sometimes we need to verbalize these things because we'll think that. I don't want to be rude. All of heaven starts to rejoice in if you stood up and wanted to accept Christ. Then Peter said to him, Lord, verse 41, do you speak this parable only to us or to all people? And the Lord said, I mean, you know, it's appropriate to ask Jesus questions. He's still answering questions. Who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his master will make ruler over his household to give them their portion of food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will make him ruler over all that he has. But if that servant says in his heart, how many know you can keep your mouth shut and your heart is still chattering? Amen. If you have somebody saying something to you and you're exhibiting the last fruit of the Holy Spirit, love, peace, gentleness, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, long-suffering, and self-control. Let's say you're hearing something, or you're involved in something, or you're experiencing something, or you're in the atmosphere of something that causes you to want to really speak up and be mean, but you're demonstrating self-control through the power of the Holy Spirit, but your heart, but he says in his heart, your heart, you're still cussing them out. In your heart, you've already still whooped them three times in your mind. In your heart, you've already told them what's up. Hello, is this real Christianity? How many of you know that God's not done cleaning you up? Don't just sit there and be really proud that you kept your mouth shut because you didn't want to. You know, a true changed heart is when you hear that thing and you're part of that environment and you're sitting there, not only are you not angry or sad or mad, you actually start praying for them in your heart. That's a changed heart. Don't settle for just keeping your mouth shut. Settle with a pure, clean heart. For those who have a pure heart, what? Shall see God. You'll see manifest in your life. That one. Let's keep praying. Let's pray through it. Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will make him ruler over all that he has. But if that servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat the male and female servants, and eat and drink and be drunk. I mean, you know, you can get tired of waiting. You just get tired. Amen. You feel like, well, maybe the Lord's not just not coming. Maybe he's not going to come in my generation. Maybe he'll come in my child's generation or something. If you start to get discouraged that way, ask the Lord for a fresh touch. He desires to give you a fresh touch. The best time to get a fresh touch from God is when you don't want one at all. You want to be left alone. You're angry. You're hurt. You're mad. You just want everybody to be quiet and leave you alone. How many know the wolf has actively just cut you from the herd, and now all the wolves are about to attack? We need to understand how the Word of God operates. Verse 46, and the master of that servant will come on a day when he's not looking for him, and at an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him, listen to this, cut him in two, and appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. And that what? And that servant who knew his master's will and did not prepare himself or do according to his will shall be beaten with many stripes. You know, I think it's pretty mean and rude and tormenting if we read a scripture like that and not show you how to really literally do that. What does that look like, literally? What does that look like in 2018? What does that look like when I'm reading my Bible by myself? What does it say? And that servant who knew his master's will and did not prepare himself or do according to his will shall be beaten with many stripes. This is what that looks like. Lord Jesus, I believe I'm your servant. But there are times that I get really discouraged and I get tired of waiting. And Lord, I know that's my fallen nature, but I know that you have a supernatural nature. And Lord, you said, apart from you, I could do nothing. So Lord, I'm telling you right now, if it's up to anything about me, I'm going to fail it. I'm going to fail it. But with you, all things are possible. So Lord, I need you to raise up inside of me like you've never done it my entire life. Lord, there's some things I don't want to talk to you about because I don't want you to take them from my life, even though I know they are harmful to me. Lord, how many times have I had this talk with you? I am very immature. When it comes down to it, I'm a coward. And I need your help. I repent. I repent. I ask you, Lord, for your help. When I stand up, I want to be a different man. I want to be a different man. Everybody look up. Sometimes we don't need to get in a hurry. We need to stay right here. You know, there's times I go in my bedroom and I shut the door. And I'll open up my Bible on my bed and I'll get on my knees. And I feel like when I start to pray, I feel like sometimes I'm not even really getting into the heart of things until like 15 minutes into it. And we're so geared When I say hot pocket Christianity, I don't say that to be mean or rude or mocking. I say it because that's the truth. That's how we are. If our hot pocket isn't done in 45 seconds, we get mad. Amen. We get frustrated. If you go to the McDonald's drive-thru and you got to wait longer than 8 minutes, you're wanting to go talk to the manager. Amen. And that society type of deal can teach us that we do not spend time in front of the Lord. He said it. He said it in His Word. Could you not pray with me 1 hour? He said it in the garden. And He said, watch and pray. Watch and pray, lest you, everybody say you, lest you fall into temptation. Maybe sometimes we're falling into temptation because we refuse to pray. And then even go into your room and shut your door and say this, Lord, I don't feel like doing this. But I know I need to. I know I need to. I think if we stop viewing God as this, you know, now lay me down to sleep and just, if I say this, then you give me this. And if you don't give it to me, I'm mad at you. Right? Amen. Sometimes we should just spend time with Him. We should just spend time. Spend time to worship Him. What does that look like? Has anybody ever wondered, what does that look like? What does that look like? Maybe you have some property. Maybe you have a house, or maybe you have somewhere where you can walk around and start talking to God. And don't get in a hurry. Leave the cell phone in the truck or the car or the house and just tell your family, I'm done for an hour. Leave me alone in Jesus' name. I'm going to speak with my King. How many know that will profit the whole family? We get bombarded with busyness and hurriedness, and you got to get it done. And oh, just in case you got over those fears, here's your 5 more things to be afraid of. We need to turn off the TV, turn off the radio, turn off everything, and go talk with God. Go spend time with Him. Amen. The Lord's really wanting to say this. Amen. He's really wanting us to spend time with Him. And this will happen. But he who did not know, yet committed things deserving of stripes, shall be beaten with few. For everyone to whom much is given, from him much will be required. Mm-mm. And to whom much has been committed, of him they will ask the more. There's people here today that thinks that God hadn't given you very much. And I want you to put your hand on your chest, because He's given you life. He's given you much. He's given you much. What are you doing with your life? If you're married, He's given you a spouse. If you got children, the Bible's clear. That's a gift from God's throne straight to you. He's given you children. Is He given you a home, shelter? Is He given you vehicles? Has He given you a job? Has He given you friends? How many know that a friend is a gift from God? For man can receive nothing unless he receives it from heaven. We've been given so much, and we've been convinced that we ain't been given nothing. Amen. I'm so thankful. I pray that we start having a new awareness, a new sensitivity level of how great God is in our lives, how much He's really done for us. Turn to Acts chapter 6, please. There's not one title given in the body of Christ that's not a title of action. Shepherd actively watches over a flock. Evangelist, declaring and heralding God's words and truth. Prophet, speaking to the people exactly what God told them to speak. We're about to learn another one, if you hadn't already known it. Acts chapter 6. The subtitle says, 7 chosen to what?
Serve.
To serve. How many know that we'll all serve in different capacities, in different ways? Now in those days, when the numbers of the disciples was multiplying, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists, because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. I've learned in the kingdom of God, whenever you experience growth, you're going to have a heckler, a mocker, and a complainer. Somebody's going to say, that's not how you have church. I don't know how many times I've been told, Jason, I love you, but you preach wrong. And I go home and hit my knees and I say, Lord Jesus, if I'm a false prophet, if I'm a false teacher, I ask right now in Jesus' name, you save me and then kill me dead so I make sure that I don't ever do that again. How many know we need to get serious with our prayers? But sometimes we gotta leave this apprehension, leave this, I don't know what people are going to think. Who cares? Who absolutely cares? And if you do care, then ask God to strip that from you. I'm not talking about being mean or rude or hateful to people, but there comes a point that boldness, you can tell that God can bring you to a point that you don't care what people think anymore. You care about what God thinks. Even our social media is teaching us this, that if I put a picture up and I don't get so many likes, I'm now wondering what's wrong with me. Or if I put a video up and then people are not viewing it, what's wrong with me? What's going on? How many know you got one view and one like that counts, and that's King Jesus. He's the one watching you. He's the one that's viewing you. And that's the only one that counts. You can give a hand to the Lord. Amen. Verse 2, then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, it is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. He said, serve tables. Those two words together mean deaconess, or the word deacon. Everybody that's been in Texas longer than 5 minutes probably heard the word deacon. Amen. It's a title in the church. It's a title of action. In this church, it's called a lay pastor. It's literally saying that every single title, every single ordained gift that God has given you is going to be a gift of action. Our Lord came to work. Amen. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit. You know, God will cause you to sit still in the church for a season. Do you know why? To redeem your reputation. Amen. There's a season in our life that we might be known for that. And God will allow you a season of being quiet and learning and growing. And that reputation will be forgotten about. And then He'll raise you up in the reputation He wants to give you. Good reputation. Full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. We have some business to tend to. Verse 4, but we will give ourselves continually, everybody say continually, to prayer and the ministry of the word. Some are called to serve tables. Some are called deacons. Some are called to pray and labor in the word. The Bible declares that an elder is deserving of double honor. Why? Those who labor in the word. Amen. We're all called. Where is God calling you to serve? Just let that sit for a second. You know, when I first heard the calling on my life, when God said, this is what I'll have you do, He raised me up out of the church I was sitting in and said, you'll go over here. How many know that you can even be called to a church? You can be called to a church for a season to learn something. And then guess what? After that season of teaching, God needs to raise you up and move you to a different one. You know why? Because you're no longer going to grow any further in that church. Amen. This is how God operates. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. In my study Bible here, I love the comment that it says, the reason why the apostles knew that prayer had to be continual and ministering to people had to be continual is because spiritual warfare is continual. It's not speaking death on anybody. That's the truth. The enemy can be relentless, and we need to learn how to fight. Amen. You need to learn how to fight for your marriage. You need to learn how to fight for your children. You need to learn how to fight for your family. You need to learn how to fight for your business. Do you realize you'd have to defend? You'll have to defend your finances? Theft of identity, fraud. When I was over in Nairobi, Kenya, and this doesn't happen here. Are you listening? Yet. But I'm a big giver. Ask my wife. She's like, can we keep some of it? Amen. When I was over there in Nairobi, the minister said, Pastor, be careful who you give your money to. Because I see some, the whole country was poor. My goodness, our poor here are wealthy compared to what my eyes were touching. I was like, and I'm sitting there going, he's a minister. Why? But Jesus did say you'll always have the poor with you, right? I was like, okay, explain. He said, witch doctors and witches will purposely see that you're a man of God, and they will come up to you and ask for money, and they know you, Christian giving heart. You give them that money, they don't spend it, they take it straight home and start putting witchcraft and curses on that. You're like, Jason, we're covered by the blood of Jesus, that can't touch me. Let me read you something. How many of you believe the Bible is true? How many of you believe the whole Bible is true? I'll read you something out of Ezekiel. How many of you know that God never changes? How many of you know the book of Ecclesiastes, the wisest man that walked the earth other than Jesus said, there's nothing new under the sun. People in America or people in Texas like to dabble in witchcraft. Over in Nairobi, they'll cut off their own arm to get more power. Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 18 says, thus says the Lord God, woe to the woman who sew magic charms on their sleeves and make veils for the heads of the people of every height and to hunt souls. We have a very powerful woman of God that comes to first service. She's read the Bible like 10 times and hand wrote it one time. Think she's pretty serious about her Christianity? And she's going to a woman's conference on an airplane. And she's praying and fasting for this woman's conference because she wants ladies to be set free, ladies to stop getting beat and harassed and tormented, ladies to get saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. So they're praying and fasting for the speakers, for the ladies that are going to be there. And next to her sits a very nice-looking, well-dressed man. And the stewardess comes by and says, hey, would you like some peanuts or something like that? Anybody that's ever ridden on a plane knows that this is common talk. And she said, no, thank you, I'll just take water. He said the same thing, I'll just take water. And after she went on to the next aisles of seats, he leaned over and says, are you praying and fasting? She said, I am. She was intrigued and impressed at his perception, how he just kind of picked up on that. And he goes, what are you fasting for? He said, well, we're going to a women's conference. We're praying that they get saved and that they, you know, be set free and ladies stop getting beat and tormented and harassed. And we're just praying for all the ladies that'll be at the conference, the speakers on the way to the listener. And she goes, are you praying and fasting? He said, I am. She said, what are you praying and fasting for? He said, death and destruction to all Christian pastors. I'm a Satanist. My wife has witnessed me witness to a Satanist at the airport. This is not Hollywood silliness. This is real-life Christianity. And what I've learned about traveling to other countries is that sometimes, and no disrespect to us because we only know what we know, sometimes it's like we're playing games over here, but you better get serious to even survive over there. It says this, verse 18, thus says the Lord God, woe to the woman who sew magic charms on their sleeves and make veils for the heads of people every height to hunt souls. Will you hunt the souls of my people and keep yourselves alive? What does that tell you? What did the Word of God just tell you? There's people out there that are hunting, and they ain't hunting deer. And will you profane me among my people for handfuls of barley and for pieces of bread, killing people who should not die and keeping people alive who should not live by your lying to my people who listen to lies? Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I'm against your magic charms by which you hunt souls there like birds. I will tear them from your arms and the souls, and let the souls go, the souls you hunt like birds. And it goes on and on and on and on. Yes, at times you need to defend your finances. Would you like to know how I do it at our house? Raise your hand if you'd want to know the prayer that I pray over my finances. Amen. I say, Lord Jesus, you said in your word, give and it will be given unto thee. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and overflowing. This is scripture if you want to look it up. Google it, amen. And overflowing, will God cause other men to pour blessings into your lap, for with the same measure you have given, God will give back unto thee. So in the name of Christ Jesus, Satan, I bind you off our finances. You will not touch them anymore. And I command you to leave us alone. You'll go somewhere else and harm somebody. You ain't going to touch us anymore. For it is written, give, and it will be given unto thee. And I say that. And I'm going to tell you right now, every time I've prayed that prayer, because, you know, you can be working hard and it seems like the money's not going anywhere. It's like it's disappearing. Or you can be praying and finally you get a little extra money and the transmission go out. Hello? This is real life Christianity. And I pray that if you don't leave this church thinking it's weird, I believe that you'll learn something on how to defend your family a little bit better. If you believe that, say amen. Amen, I do too. He goes on. How many of you know that Stephen, verse 5, and the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. And they picked 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 more men, because I butchered their names last service. Verse 6, whom they set before the apostles, listen to this, when they had prayed, they laid hands on them. Brother Dwayne, that's powerful, isn't it? That's why you see at the end of each year, when we get new leaders up here, we'll come up and lay our hands on them. That's not Pentecostal. That's not Church of God, Assemblies of God. That's Christian. That's kingdom operations. Lay your hands on them and stir up that gift that is within you by the laying on of hands. Amen? When you lay your hands on them and pray for them, God stirs that gift up inside them, and they start operating that gift, and it takes the work and spreads it out. This is how God wants us to operate. Verse 7, then the word of God spread, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient. Everybody say obedient to the faith. How many know that when you're obedient to Christ, you're serving Christ? You're serving Christ. I have one last scripture. It's in Revelation chapter 19. Lord, help me. You know, over there in Nairobi, they don't have church. They will not have church unless there's 1 hour of constant prayer and declarations, and 1 hour of praise and worship. And the third hour is when they start church with an hour of praise and worship. Wow. And it's one of those times that I pray, I believe this church will eventually get there. I believe we're not quite there yet. But you can ask Josh, you and ask other people who have experienced it. You walk in this church and you have a strong desire just to get on your knees and worship God. It's like you're very careful, and you can tell that God is moving. Amen. Revelation chapter 19, starting at verse 1. After these things, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Alleluia. Salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth. Listen to this, with her fornication. You know how you say fornication in the Greek? Porneia, porn, pornography. He judged the harlot that corrupted the earth. Sexual immorality and pornography corrupts a good thing. And he has avenged on her the blood of his servants shed by her. It tells me that there's many a saints fallen in battle to pornography. Verse 3, again they said, Alleluia, her smoke rises up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped. Everybody say worshiped. God who sat on the throne, saying, Amen and Alleluia. Then a voice came from the throne saying, Praise our God, all you his servants. And those who fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters and the sound of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright. For the fine, listen to this, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. Now listen, for we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So unto salvation, we're considered washed by the blood of Jesus and righteous and holy. If we weren't, we would not go to heaven, we would go to hell. But Calvary did a complete work. Jesus did a complete work on Calvary. But also, the Bible talks about clothing and armor of God. It says in water baptism, clothe yourself in Christ. And now you heard it with your own ears, Revelation chapter 19, that you can clothe yourself in fine linen by the righteous acts of the saints. I believe that how can somebody tell you're a Christian? How can spiritual warfare, how can they tell? Can they tell if you're a serious Christian or just saved? You know, we've had a 27-year Wiccan witch get saved in this church, and she would testify, I could tell if you were serious or if you were playing games. She said this, she said the demons that occupied her would tell her this, that Christian is not powerful. You can walk right by it and even manipulate them. They didn't even know you're there. But she said there's some Christians that the demons that occupied her would make her cross the street and go the other way. Amen. I believe that Jesus is the light. That's not a flashlight. That's a fire. And if you abide in him and he in you, that the enemy can see that fire raging inside of you. And then even more so if you're obedient to the Holy Spirit, you're obedient to the Word of God. Not a work salvation, but you're saved, so now you get to work, and now you're obedient to Christ. I believe now different fine linens and clothes get on you. If you went to a military base right now, you would see all soldiers in the same uniform, but you could identify the difference between a private and a general. Amen. You could see the difference between a sergeant, boots on the ground, show enough sergeant, and a major. You could tell a little distinctive difference. And I believe that as this world goes on and on and on, as we become more obedient to Christ and we abide in him and he in us, I believe then that it'll become more safe for us to walk around. And people will see that in you and they'll come to you. If you believe that, say amen. If not, then why did God's word say that? Amen. The righteous acts of the saints. Then he said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Amen. How many of you know that if you belong to Jesus, you got reservations? Amen. I wonder what the appetizers are like there. One of heaven's version of fried cheese. Or dessert. Amen. Y'all know there's a dessert in New York that's $25,000. Served with a gold spoon. And it ain't got nothing on what heaven's got waiting for his children. Blessed are the ones who's going to be at the marriage wedding supper. Amen. And I fell at his feet to worship him. This because an angel told him this. But he said to me, see that you do not do that. I'm your fellow servant. Band, you can come, please. And your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus, worship God. For the testimony of Jesus is the Spirit of prophecy. You know if you know Jesus or not. You know if he's stirring on you to accept him, and you know if he's stirring on you to serve him more and more. Amen. And the Lord wanted me to say this. I said it first service. Serving God doesn't have to mean jump on a plane and go to Nairobi, Kenya. Even though if he's telling you to do that, you do that. Because he's got a blessing waiting on you. How many know that you'll bring treasures back from where you go? You can't help it. But serving God is also this right here. Just one step. So what is serving God to you? What is God the Holy Spirit telling you? Then do that. Don't try to be like your neighbor on your right and left, but do what God's telling you. Let me remind you this. Where's Rebecca? Stand up, Miss Rebecca. Everybody look at her. Remember what she announced at the beginning of service. We have almost 1,000 students and staff that need to be prayed for. They need prayer partners. And she's going to go meet you back at that table. And I pray if you got to wait 10 minutes to get your name down and to somebody to pray for, I pray that you wait. Because somebody on the other end sure will be glad that you did. Because there's some people that are not blessed like many families in here. There's some families that have no Christians at all in their family, and they go home to addictions, abuse, and every other vile thing. And they're praying that somebody is going to be praying for them. Amen. Could we all stand, please? Two things. Remember at the beginning, serving God is worshiping God, and worshiping God is serving God. If you feel led to stay and worship one song, if you don't feel led to stay and you feel led to go over to that table and sign up to pray for somebody, that's serving God too. But in Jesus' name, do something. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for your grace. I thank you, Lord, that you're patient with us. Lord, I thank you. You're so patient. You can have this message delivered 100 times. And the 100th time when we still chose to sit there and do nothing, you're still very patient. Lord, I thank you that there's no human being like you. There's none that stands beside you. Lord, I pray that you place us in a position that we have no choice but to call out to you. Lord, I thank you for those times you remind me that no man, no woman, no preacher, no child, no elderly, no stranger, no family, no nothing could save me, but only you could have saved me in that very moment. Lord, may we come to know you deeper and deeper. We love you, Lord. May you be with us as we worship you as our King. Amen.
Hello, everybody, again. You just finished listening to the sermon today. And I have another scripture. Imagine that. Lots of God's Word being poured into you today or tonight or however, what time this message is reaching you. But in Mark chapter 4, verse 15, it talks about the parable of the sower. And the seed, God's seed, is God's Word. And listen to this real quick. It says, "And these are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in your hearts." So since God's word has been sown in your heart during that message, it is our prayer that God solidifies that seed and protects it and watches over it, and may it be watered. And just as God's word says, may he give the increase. And I pray he gives the increase of salvation in your life. And I need you to hear this real quick. I need you to pause what you're doing. I need you to listen. And I pray these words sink deep down into your soul. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So if you do believe that to be true, then I pray that you say this prayer. And you know what? You don't want to say it if you don't mean it. But if you do believe it and you do mean it, then you need to confess it. You know, when the gospel of Jesus Christ is preached, it fills up your heart. And you desire to be saved. So you just say a simple prayer like this. You say, "Lord Jesus, I ask that you forgive me of all my sins. And I ask that you come into my life and be the boss of my life. Today I confess you as Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Be Lord of my life." And if you did that, your salvation is totally and completely secured. And I would encourage you to go tell somebody that you got saved today or tonight or whenever you heard this message. And I pray we see you again back at the sermon section. I pray you come and visit us in person if you're around this local area. But either way, may God bless you, and we love y'all in Jesus' name. Bye-bye.